Friends, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Amen, amen. A few announcements for you, as you can see on the screen behind me, or following your programs as well. To cover again some of our reopening plans, even in the midst of constantly, seemingly changing guidelines. Friends, we encourage you to wear a mask while you're here, just to make sure that we control the coronavirus as best as we can. We also encourage you that if you're not feeling well, to stay at home. You can always live stream. We have options for that. Kale, who knows? I'm going to just bounce around here and make your life even more interesting. You're welcome. But live streaming options are within the building as well as at home. For those of you tuning in, we want to remind you and encourage you as well to text in that you're here, text in or message, at least on Facebook, your prayer requests and whatnot. But also, if you would rather watch somewhere else in the building, live streaming options are in the parlor as well as they're up and running in the library this morning. Larry and Sandy Rogers have continuously been downstairs keeping an eye on that entrance place. So you get a chance to tell them thank you. They do the work of setting that up, which can get to be a little bit tiresome at times if you're the only one doing it. So Larry and Sandra, thank you. A couple of notes as well, my friends. Even with the hand of fellowship, we want to practice social distancing for the hand of fellowship, even online here, or if you're on your phone at the hand of fellowship time, to tune in here in church and to click in and say good morning to folks as well. It is fascinating to see how many people chime in and watch our services. We have a real count. It's a pretty impressive number there. So friends out there, good morning. Friends out here, good morning. We practice good hygiene here as best as we possibly can. Wash your hands. Use the hand sanitizers. When the machine gets a little goofy with you, please forgive it. Don't punch it. Just let it squirt out. Hand sanitizer, it has its own schedule, that's for sure. But make sure that we can control the coronavirus and other stuff as well by practicing good hygiene. And for our offering, we have baskets both by year where Dale greeted you out there, as well as right outside here on our welcome center with all those baskets with the spare masks and whatnot. If you're interested, drop off your offerings there or mail them in or to use Mainco, our online giving option. And again, I've got to keep on saying it, friends, you continue to impress me and astound me by how you continue to give and worship God through the giving of your tithes and offerings. And just incredible how you continue to be generous. If you're interested in serving here at Mercy Methodist Church and or want to learn how to do this whole live streaming video thing, or if you want to learn how to video edit or whatnot, please let us know at the church. Right now, I'm the only person, and sooner or later, I'm going to go on vacation. Whew. Hopefully sooner rather than later, but that being said, we'd love to be able to still have this going on when I go on vacation, or if I'm sick on a Sunday morning and can't be here. So, if you're interested, it's not that hard, it just takes some technicalities. And as I've mentioned before, we already have one person, but she's going into third grade, right? Yeah. So, just saying, friends, third grade. That being said, also, there's something else, Kale, that I forgot to write down.
There's no slides other than reopening and the thank you slide.
Thank you, then. Final note, if you haven't noticed around here, with everything going on and our trustees being focused on finding estimates and whatnot for our roof, that we'll have to have a new roof put on, some things had gone by the wayside. Ronnie Gary was here the last couple weeks and has completely cleared out all of the weeds over here. That for Vacation Bible School, it looked like we had a short jungle going on over by the garbage can side here. Ronnie came out here and cleaned that completely up. It looks glorious. So although Rodney's not here, if you see him, make sure you tell him hi. Hopefully Michelle, you see him also. Yeah. Because Ronnie did an incredible job cleaning there. Friends, let's greet one another with the love of Christ. Friends, you can find the call to worship on the screens behind me. At home, you can find what we've emailed out and posted to the Facebook page. Friends, before we go to our call to worship, though, let's pray. And so, Father, we cling to the fact that you are our God. Move and work in our midst. Strengthen us, calm us, heal us. We thank you so much for your incredible love for us because you are worthy of praise. We come before you now offering up this time, reminding ourselves and telling you that you are our God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, let's stand together for our call to worship. Take from Psalm 46. God, you are our refuge and strength.
Lord, you are always near in times of great trouble.
That's why we won't be afraid when worlds fall apart.
The Lord of heavenly forces is with us. Our God is our place and safety.
As the Lord said, now know that I am God. I am exalted among all nations. I am exalted throughout the world.
Our God is our place of safety. Let us praise the Lord.
Amen, my friends. Let us praise the Lord. But for those of you at home, we have a change of the song. It's the Spirit Song Prime by Wimber. If you're ready, then. Friends, let's sing together. So, for those of you who are out there, you guys the kids are here, put the mask on. For those of you who are wondering what that was, we have a couple of youngsters up here with keychains, somebody's got car keys, and somebody's jealous she forgot hers. Oh, she has mine in her own. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, I've got a question for you. You ready? Throw a number out at me. How many times do you think Jesus asked questions in the Bible? Go ahead, just throw a number at me. And I'll say higher or lower. We're not there with you. What's that? 10? Higher! Higher than 10. Who's got a number bigger? What's that, Jason? Not 6,000. Good guess. Lower than 6,000. Addie, you had a number? 16. Higher than 16. Ashlyn, how high? What number do you think? How many times do you think Jesus asked questions we have in the Bible? A ton. That'd be 2,000. Less than 2,000. What do you think, Ashlyn? Go ahead, throw a number out. You think 2,000? Still not 2,000. Can I tell you how many times Jesus asked questions?
No.
No? Jordan's going to know. Okay. She'll be back. Sitting still is tough for all of us, huh? So guess what? Jordan's going to be cranky for a second. That's all right. Jesus asked 307 questions in the Bible. Now, have your parents ever seen me get tired of you asking questions? Yeah, they probably do. Why is the sky blue? Why is grass green? Those are the questions I might ask when I was your age. You may be asking, what is the square root of pi? But that's another thing entirely. Ask David Cook. He taught math. He knows. No, David, you don't want to give that away? Square root of pi is less than 2. That much I can tell you. Moving on. So, you guys don't care about that? 307 different questions Jesus asked, including this question. Ready? From Luke chapter 9. Once when Jesus was praying by himself, the disciples joined him, and he asked the disciples, "Who do the crowd say that I am?" So they answered him, and then Jesus asked him this question, "Who do you think I am?" So, Jesus asked a whole lot of questions. Oh, thank you. Yeah, for my microphone. Good. Thanks. So, Jesus asked over 307 questions. It's okay to ask questions. Now, we need to take a moment here. When you sit in church here, you look at the pictures, you look at the banners, maybe you look at the thing right behind you. What questions have you ever had? Go ahead. There's not going to be any dumb questioning. Why did it used to be gray? Why did it used to be? What used to be gray? Everywhere in the world, you mean, or inside the church building? Why did it used to be gray? I think it's because the paint color that had been white needed to change because it was a little dirty. And that's the simple answer. We also try to make it blue to give a little pop of color. Does that answer your question? Between us, I think what they used to paint it white, though, because Jesus makes our sins as white as snow. The bad thing with white, though, is like the paint, if you don't keep on it, it can look a little tacky quickly. So that's another reason why we use the other paint colors. Is that a good answer? All right, anybody ask another question for me?
No.
Okay. Yeah, what is it actually? What's that? You're being silly. Oh, God. But that is a neat thing, because think of it this way, Ashlyn, you may be being a little silly, but why would God even create bugs? Like, why mosquitoes? Why ladybugs? Why did God make lightning bugs? Well, I think God made lightning bugs because they're a lot of fun. I mean, why or fireflies? Fireflies, right. So, when I see how many different kind of bugs are out there, that tells me that God enjoys so many different things instead of just making it all simple. Like, is there any one person in the world that looks just like you? No. And I knew twins, quite a few sets of twins. Daniel and David jump out of me. Those two guys were exact opposites. Daniel was driven. David just was happy-go-lucky. Daniel loved working with computers. David loved working with his hands like as a plumber. You know, those two guys are completely different and they look the same. So what's neat is God has this creativity. All right, any more questions?
No.
All right, because you know what? There's so many questions in the world to ask. For example, why in the world would you call candy a cowtail? Like, who wants to eat a cow's tail? And it's not cooked, so it's raw. Who wants to eat raw cowtail?
Not
me. I do. It's delightful. Yeah. Who would want to chew on bubble gum that looked like an eyeball? Why would you do that besides Halloween's coming and I lost my eye? I'm like, thank you. At least you guys could see. Yeah, that was a nice score. Moving on. And of course, we also have here Reese cups, but they're Frankenstein Reese cups. So guess what? They have green in them. Who would put green in a Reese's cup?
Yeah.
Weird, huh? So ask questions, because guess why? Jesus did. You want eyeballs?
Okay.
Let's pray first and I'll get you some candy. Father, thank you so much how you brought Jesus. Help us to ask questions. And we're asking that you help us find answers. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Wonderful.
All right, guys, here we go. Who here would like some eyeballs?
They're bubblegum.
Eyeballs? Let me stand up. There's no light coming out yet. All right, Ashley, you ask first. Come on over.
You want, here we go, kid. You want two? I accidentally gave you three.
Can you share one with Vienna for me?
Jason, what would you like?
Eyeballs, Reese's, cowtails. One cowtail?
Whoa, there you go. You want one of these?
Annie, what would you like? Okay. Anything you think is safe with yours? I'm not thinking eyeball.
What?
You want me to just keep dropping these and you're not paying attention?
One.
Okay. Up this side. There we go. Friends, what would you like to thank God for this morning? What would you like to praise God for who God is? And friends, what do we need to be praying for?
Thank you.
And so, my friends, what would you like to thank God for this morning? What would you like to praise God for who God is? And also, what do we need to be praying for? Rick.
Richard's mother had both her knees replaced. She's doing pretty good. Pray for her. Come back. Yeah.
Want to be praying for Rick's back? I heard that right. And then two, also Sue Jake and Richard's mom have both knees replaced on the 18th. So prayer for recovery for her as well. Rick, thank you. Friends, anything else you need to be thanking God for? You want to praise God for who God is? Anything else you need to be praying for? Linda.
I think that had a beautiful summer.
You're right, today. Although the drought, the mild drought we have is difficult, with the pandemic being closed up even more so inside, instead of being able to get out, it would be very hard if we had a very wet summer. You're right. We've been blessed in that regard. Thank you. David.
Yes, we need to pray for our country and for our neighbors.
Amen. We need to pray for our country and our neighbors. Friends, anything else you want to thank God for? Rick, Dick, I just called you Richard because I'm still thinking about Richard G. Don't mind me.
My son, though, is a junior. Who's Rick? Prayers for Linda. She's not feeling well today. Special prayers for Sally Boggs. And also Jack and Shirley Talon, health issues.
Thank you, Dick. So for Linda Carlson not feeling well, Sally Boggs, who is not feeling well at all, as well, and has moved home. And then Jack and Shirley Town as well. Thanks, Dave. Friends, anything else we need to be praying for? We want to thank God for it. Praise God for who God is. Let's be looking at being Gary Rodney's brother was in an, we call it a moped?
No, it was a mini bike.
A mini bike accident. I should call it a moped. That's a brother. Guys who ride those things, you're a little iffy if you start calling for one. So, he was in an accident on his bike. So, we're praying for being here with some issues with the accident, and also unexplained rapid heart rate loss. So, we're praying for him. And then, also, as well, we're praying for Katie Woods' family. Katie passed away, I believe, within the last couple of days. So, there will be a private funeral service for the Woods family. So, we're praying for the whole Woods family. Friends, is there anything else you want to thank God for? Praise God for who God is. Anything we need to be praying for? Also, I ask you to keep praying for my mom, Ruth. She's at her house. She lives there by herself. This is, in some ways, a different kind of stress for me on a selfish level, let alone for her to be able to handle the exhaustion that comes from chemotherapy while she lives at home. So if you don't mind praying for my mom, Ruth, it's friends, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. God, you are our refuge and strength. You are our help, always near in times of trouble. Psalm 46 reminds us that you are our refuge, you are our strength, that you're near in times of trouble. Instead of disappearing like some friends might, you are there in the midst of the trouble caring for us. Father, you are our refuge that we can hide from the storms of life in. You are our strength, especially when we feel like we have nothing left. What a gift it is, Lord, that we can cling to you. We may turn to other devices, we may turn to other people, we may turn to other means, we may turn to other addictions, but you are the God who is our refuge and our strength, a sure help in times of trouble. Thank you, Father, we can count on you. And so, Father, with that in mind, we come before you asking to be with Dan Garen in recovery from both the accident, even maybe more so, the unexplained heart rate drop that happened. We pray for healing for Dan, that you be with the family in Jesus' name. Father, we ask that you would also be with Sue Chapin in the midst of her recovery from both knees being operated upon. We pray, Father, for healing in Jesus' name. We pray for healing for Rick's back in Jesus' name. Father, we look before you. Linda Carlson and Sally Boggs, as well as Jack and Shirley Town. We pray for healing, Lord, in Jesus' name. Father, come before you as well. In the midst of the turmoil, pandemic, and whatnot that our country faces and our leaders and decisions they have, we pray, Father, that you would give wisdom to our leaders. With the election cycle coming into focus, we pray for guidance for each and every one of us and how you would have us work. We also ask, Father, that you not only would guide and direct our leaders, but move and work in the midst of our country. With protests that are peaceful and protests that are not peaceful, for people being attacked without cause, and for some systemic issues of racism, we pray for healing for our country in Jesus' name. Lord, I'll free my mom, Ruth. I pray for healing for her, and I pray against the cancer in Jesus' name. Father, we also thank you because we've seen your hands at work for so many of us to be able to not just survive but thrive in the midst of this pandemic. We give you thanks. Father, for your hand moving and working in our lives, especially when it's been so hard and difficult, we give you thanks. For the safety and protection you've given us with our families, with our church, with ourselves, in the midst of the coronavirus outbreak, we give you thanks. For how we've seen such beautiful weather this summer, as Linda reminded us of. Your hand at work in our lives when it could have been so much worse. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for rain. We know we need it. We also praise you for this beautiful summer we've been blessed with. Father, we want to thank you and praise you as we praise Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory forever.
Amen.
Friends, Karen Wagner was suckered, blessed to be able to be asked to read this morning on our reader mail schedule. Could not make it today. So as Karen makes her way forward, my friends, why don't we pray? And so, friends, let us pray.
Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today.
Amen. Good morning, Karen.
The scripture this morning is taken from Psalms 46, verses 1 through 11. God is our refuge and strength, a help always near in times of great trouble. That's why we won't be afraid when the world falls apart, when the mountains crumble into the center of the sea, when its waters roar and rage, when the mountains shake because of its surging waves. There is a river whose streams gladden God's city, the holiest dwelling of the Most High. God is in that city. It will never crumble. God will help it when morning dawns. Nations roar, kingdoms crumble. God utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of heaven forces us, the Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. Come, see the Lord's deeds, what devastation he has imposed on the earth, bringing wars to an end in every corner of the world, breaking the bow and shattering the spear, burning chariots with fire. That's enough. Now, know that I am God. I am exalted among all nations. I am exalted throughout the world. The Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety.
Friends, it's the word of God, people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Amen. Karen, thank you. Friends, this morning's going to be a little different. It's easy to have a sermon and I talk at folks at times. You may want to tune me out. But as we deal with the fact that the coronavirus is a part of our lives and this pandemic has settled in since the month of March, doing very quickly with my app, that's 5 months. We're almost at half a year with this oppressive sense of the coronavirus. And the fear that it brings, instead of just talking, we put maybe to put into practice what Psalm 46 suggests, to put our trust in God, to rest in God, and to intentionally rest. Not just talk about resting, but to actually rest. So this morning we're going to try something a little different. Please bear with me as we try to look at how to take care of ourselves in the midst of this pandemic. This is something you can do by yourself, but the danger of the pandemic is this, friends. We spend way too much time by ourselves. We spend way too much time by ourselves or maybe with our spouses. There are times where I ache to be able to spend more time with my wife. I'm saying it right out loud now. She may be able to watch this on camera. Now, I don't know. There are moments. There's so much time we spend together that it feels like it's not overkill, but there's so much time together in comparison to seeing other people. So this is not perfect. When David penned these words for the Israelites, it was to be practiced in a community. We would have said that when we read the Bible, because if you're like me, you're normally reading the Bible by yourself, or with Tina and I with our devotions in the morning, we read it together, two people. When the original words would be read, it would be read in a community setting like this. Not once a week, but every day. So we've sort of lost that. So this is not perfect. Please do not assume this is perfect. But hopefully these will be some cool tools for us to have a little bit of self-care in the midst of the coronavirus. From Psalm 46, verse 1, God is our refuge and strength, a help always near in times of great trouble. So, I need you to dream, I need you to think, I'm asking you to spend a little bit of time thinking about what is your refuge. Is that a place, like camp, or your recliner? Is it a person? Like your spouse, memories of a parent, or is it a memory of something else you have, or even a feeling? What is that refuge? Does that make sense? You have that place, that person, that feeling in your mind of what your refuge is. Now, the scriptures tell us that God is our refuge and strength, but we also have that sense of feeling for someone else, someplace else, where our refuge is. Do you have that feeling of that refuge within you? Do you have that sense? How does it make you feel? For me, as I think about it right now, when I was in college, it was on Grove City College's campus where I could find some time alone in the midst of some trees or whatnot praying. Or now as a married person at home with the TV on and maybe watching and maybe not, but spending that time with my wife, that sense of refuge. The security, the feeling that I'm not alone. For each of us is going to be different. Try to remember that sense. That feeling of refuge. Because God is our refuge, that's why we won't be afraid when, as the psalmist writes, when the mountains crumble, or when the waters roar and rage, or when the mountains shake because of the surging waves. Because when the mountains crumble, fall apart, when the road falls apart, when the mountains crumble to the center of the sea, when its waters roar and rage, when the mountains shake because of the surging waves, God is our refuge and strength. How has God been your refuge and strength? In a moment, I'll ask you for a brave volunteer to share. But how has God been your refuge and strength? How's God been your refuge and strength when life has been awful? Where have you seen God at work? How's God been your refuge and strength? Anybody feel like sharing? I've shared with you before that I was at my dad's funeral service, and all of a sudden, this verse that was not connected at all with the service went through my mind. This reminder to that to enter the kingdom of heaven, you had to become like a little child. and with after my dad's stroke and his Elohim's horrible fighting against becoming a Christian, that day where I've seen him completely change when he had the stroke and go from someone who fought against faith to someone who seemed to be so much more open. For me, that was one of those days where I felt God being a refuge and strength, where my fear was instead replaced by hope. Where is God being your refuge and strength? Friends, if you're online right now, I encourage you to type that in. For some of us, it's hard to speak up in church, but to actually write it down. And if you're seated, I encourage you. We have these little notes and doodle pads, which some of you know much better than others, but write ahead. Write down on there, if nothing else, for yourself, how God's been your refuge and strength. The psalmist goes on to write, as King David goes on to write, this incredible king with a heart for God, who wrote 2,500, probably closer to 3,000 years ago, in verses 4 through 7. There's a river whose streams gladden God's city, the holiest dwelling of the Most High. God is in that city. It will never crumble. God will help it when morning dawns. Nations roar. Kingdoms crumble. God utters his voice. The earth. Isn't that a place you want to go, where you're safe and secure? David's writing about Jerusalem at that point when he writes this. This was not perfect, because Jerusalem would fall. But he's also pointing to heaven, this eternal city that will never, ever fall. It's that future hope, eternal rest in heaven, that's around as the city, where it never crumbles. Black streams roll throughout. God always helping the enemy. Kind of refuge that is our future hope. How does God bring this about? From Psalm 46, verse 7. The Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. So, David writes about how Jerusalem is the place that's safe. I had that spot, as I mentioned, on the couch when I was in college. I had it on a couple places on Grove City's campus where I would go to spend time in prayer. But Psalm 46, verse 7 reminds us, the Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. The God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and Jacob's name is changed. Bonus points, I have eyeball gumballs for you. You know it. Jacob's name was changed to what? Ready? You know how to play Jeopardy scene music? No? Anybody? Does it sound like I'm playing it either? Why are my fingers doing this? Does anybody know? Probably for the piano, right? Copyright issues. I'm going to stop right there. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob's name was changed to Israel. Yeah, Carlson? We just want to be nice.
Yes, I was waiting.
Dave, I can even give you three Reese cups. Now, I don't bring this up, friends. Even greater than the places, even greater than the fields, even greater than the human person that we may find as our place of refuge, the scriptures are telling us God's even greater than that. Now, if you doubt me, because at times it feels like we don't see God around us as though God's not nearby, how does this whole angelic army thing work? Well, we've got a couple pictures I stole from the internet shamelessly, but there was no copywriting on these pages, so I grabbed them. There's an angelic choir that looks like it's about ready for battle. And Kale, the next picture is even a little more imposing. Pictures are slightly small, but this image is of the angels over those bearing shields, all part of the angelic army for God. Now, why do we need to suggest this? Friends, you have angels on your side. You have God working on your behalf. The Lord of heavenly forces is with us, and God of Jacob is our place of safety. From Exodus chapter 14, verse 19, the angel of God who was going before the Israelite army moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took his place behind them. From 1 Chronicles 14, verse 15, when you hear the sound of marching at the tops of the balsam trees, then go out to battle, for God has gone out before you to strike down the army of the Philistines. What is that They're telling David in 1 Chronicles, listen, for the angels in the trees, they're going out before you. God had that kind of power that the angelic forces were in the midst of the tops of the trees of the battle. Or, one of my favorites from Joshua chapter 5. Once when Joshua was by Jericho, he looked up and saw a man standing before him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went to the man and said to him,
are you one of us
or one of our adversaries? The man replied, neither, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell with his face to the earth and worshiped. And he said, why, what do you command your servant, my Lord? The commander of the army of the Lord said to Joshua, remove the sandals from your feet, for the place where you stand is holy. And Joshua did so. That the battle belongs to the Lord. Friends, we may not be able to see God at work in our lives, but when we trust God to be our true refuge, it's not just sort of hoping. God sends angels or an army of angels to be there amongst you. Don't discount the incredible love that God has for you, the battle for you. We're not suggesting that life will be easy, but you are not in this on your own. Because the Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. So, what do you have to fear if such protection is promised to each of us through Jesus? What do you fear? Now I'm going to ask you to name that out loud, friends. But, let's face it, what do you have to fear? It's fascinating, it's even asking a question, I had two or three words that came to my mind. What do you have to fear? Goes on in verses 8 and 9. Come, see the Lord's deeds, what devastation he's imposed on the earth. Bringing wars to an end in every corner of the world, breaking the bow, shattering the spear, burning chariots with fire. That the promises that wars will end, that weapons will be broken and useless. And who brings this about? Isn't that what? Who needs their glasses out to read that one this morning? Trying to squeeze it all on one screen? Oh boy, looks like I need to double check that one. Kale, can we blame Kale? That's not a good idea, is it? But who brings us about ultimately the ending of our wars? As Isaiah wrote about the one to come, who we name Jesus. A child is born to us, a son is given to us. An authority will be on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There will be vast authority and endless peace with David's throne before his kingdom, establishing and sustaining him with justice and righteousness now and now and forever. Where does this ultimately come from? That peace that Psalm 46 promises? Only comes from the Lord our God. So friends, what do we have to fear? Well, we can know this with our heads, can't we? We can know that our place of refuge is Jesus Christ. We can know that our refuge is the God of Jacob. We can know with our heads that God is an ever-present refuge in our place of strength. But it's another thing to put into practice. So how do we practice this? Because one of the biggest, largest distances in all of creation is this. From our heads knowing stuff about God to our hearts feeling and living out what we believe. So I need you to be intentional about finding this idea about peace. It's a difficult article that I've lifted from the American Psychiatric Association, but they noted that nearly half of Americans, 48%, are anxious about the possibility of getting coronavirus, COVID-19, and nearly 4 in 10 Americans are anxious about becoming seriously ill or dying from coronavirus. But far more Americans, 62%, are anxious about the possibility of family and loved ones getting coronavirus. Friends, a year ago, that wasn't even something we were thinking about. COVID just sounded like something that would be in a video game or some sort of movie that you'd find from Hollywood. COVID? Is that covert ops or something like that? Instead, it's a whole thing that's changed our lives. 60% of people are concerned about loved ones getting the coronavirus. Every time I take my mom, who we would call compromised with the open wound, with her ostomy bag, with her cancer in her body, every time I take her to the doctors, I feel that. Friends, the word we may have, how do we attack when we know that we serve Jesus as the Prince of Peace? How do we live life in the world of peace? All right, Kayla, here we go. Be still and know that I am God, from Psalm 46, verse 10. It's matter of fact, I dug this out of the old t-shirt collection. Here we go. On the back of it, I forgot to bring it up for the kids' message. You can't barely see it. You guys need the glasses again, don't you, from whatever you're trying to read the screen before. There it is. We still know that I'm God. I can put it on a t-shirt. That's great. It's another thing to actually know it. The King James Version, the NIV, the ESV, the NRSV are all different translations from the original Hebrew into English. Now, when they translate Psalm 46:10, it's this. Be still and know that I am God. The Living Bible, stand silent. Know that I am God. The Complete Jewish Bible, put it this way, I found this translation fascinating. Desist and know that I am God. The CEV says, calm down and learn that I am God. The CEV, that's enough. Now know that I am God. The NASB, New American Standard Bible, puts it this way. Cease striving and know that I am God. And the Orthodox Jewish Bible, be still and know that I am Elohim. Let's look at first Elohim, which means mighty one. Elohim meant that when the God, name for God was used in the Old Testament, it meant the God over all other gods, the God over everything. In creation, in Genesis 1, the name that's given to God is Elohim. It's weirdly a plural name, like you might have dogs and cats. It's weird because it almost says gods. And yet Elohim points at mighty one, or mighty God. The God over all things. Be still and know that I am the mighty God. Be still, or desist. Calm down. Be still. Friends, are you ready for a little bit of interaction? For some of you, I may just put you to sleep right now because you may actually need it. One of the exercises I've been learning is this ability to take a deep breath. It's fascinating what it can do for your mind. No wonder Buddhists have been using or stolen meditation for the last 2,500 years or so because of the effectiveness of it. I agree, George, because meditation even has this bad knock for Christians. And yet, Buddhism's only been around for 2,500 years. Christianity, or at least this idea of worshiping Elohim, God who found himself fully realized that Jesus has been around for 4,000 to 6,000 years. Why do we bring that up? I would suggest the Buddhists stole this from Christians. Because even in Psalm 63, there's David in the middle of the night telling, writing down about the middle of the night, with joy in my life, whenever I ponder you on my bed, whenever I meditate on you in the middle of the night, from Psalm 63. King David, the author of Psalm 46 as well, found joy when he thought about God, when he meditated on who God is. So to be still. My encouragement to you right now is to close your eyes and take a deep breath. You want to let that exhale of breath go almost 30 seconds. I'll count for you. For some of you, you're going to find this incredibly frustrating. Others of you are already doing it, trying to tune me out. Good. If you're ready, take that deep breath in and then exhale. Breath in and a huge breath out. One more time. A deep breath in. And exhale. psychologically what you're doing is you're removing the effect of the prefrontal cortex, which is often reactionary in how you react to life. From our brains, we often react too quickly from there. When we breathe that deeply in, we're engaging more and more of our brain. Now, that's just on a physical sense. That's just on that mental sense. There is something about slowly taking that time to breathe. Now, why do you bring that up? Well, the Holy Spirit is called pneuma in Greek and ruah in Hebrew. It's a word for spirit, wind, and breath. When we pray, let's not dismiss the fact that we take our time and intentionally breathe. We might just be giving more and more room to the Holy Spirit in our lives. Friends, I find that when I try to sit still and do it in my own power, you know what happens? Sat down right over here, and I remember Anna told me that the microphone cover fell off. I went over there, sat down for 30, like not even 30 seconds, and realized I forgot that. I wanted to pray in between that we're making sure I'm ready for this time, and instead, my to-do list starts clicking in. When I try to sit still, guess what happens? To-do, I need to do this, I need to do that. Anna, thank you, because you reminded me this, it makes this thing better. Thank you. That being said, I take away because got stuff to do. And Psalm 46:10 says, be still, or calm down, or desist for a second. Put the to-do list away. Be still and know that I'm God. When we take the time to breathe, it helps us reorient. That's just mentally, friends. Let alone, how much more do we give space for God? Be still and know that God is God, the mighty one, God over all. That word know in Hebrew is so much more than just what we might think of with our heads. I know, for example, Kale's in the sound booth. I know that Dick Carlson didn't know that, I'm just joking, Dick, I'm just going to like, I owe you an eyeball bubblegum piece. No, all kidding aside, we might know stuff with our head. That's not at all what it meant. It's that kind of knowing whenever you know that you see your grandkids about to step into the road, what are you going to do? Yell, scream, run over and grab them. Parents with little ones, you know exactly what it is. The feeling that I have to act. Or, when you're sitting there on the couch with your loved ones, and it's an enjoyable time, and you know there's nowhere else you'd rather be. It's that kind of knowing, not just with your head, but with how you live life, with that instant action because you need to fix something to save someone else, or to enjoy the moment. Be still and know that I'm God. David's reminding us that there's a lot to do, but friends, it can bear them a lot to do. It's the one who we would do it for. And greater yet than getting stuff done is actually knowing. Be still and know that I'm God. Okay, are you good? Okay. Sigmund Freud in 1926, who was not somebody at all that would even equate with being a Christian, it looks like, maybe towards the end of his life. But much of what he wrote about seemed to be God-less compared to God-fool. But Sigmund Freud did put it this way. Whenever in 1926 he had oral cancer and then began to have heart trouble, to the point that this man, who was known for his ability to write and study humans, suddenly returned to Vienna after an extended stay in the hospital. And for the first time in his life, he experienced Vienna in springtime. He actually knew about Vienna. I mean, you may be able to read about it or see a picture in a postcard, but Freud put it this way. What a pity that one has to grow old and ill before making this discovery. He never knew how beautiful Vienna was until he slowed down. Be still and know that I'm God. So friends, let's name our troubles. Do this to for yourself, your fears, your worries. Tell God that you need God's help. For Pat Grace Confer, it might be Joel and Sally, the missionaries of Beirut, as I mentioned 2 weeks ago. for Rodney, let alone Michelle Gary, it might be Dan, and what's going on with himself. The worries, the fears. For some of us, it's our kids or grandkids going back to school. And whether it's being at home online, which is tricky enough, or going to school, which may be a little riskier, the troubles and fears. For some of us, will I get to see this little one again? What's going to happen? For some of us, I'm getting older, and who's going to help me? Our troubles, our fears, our worries. Tell God that you need God's help. I'll give you 30 seconds here or so. Whatever those worries and fears were that we thought of before that come to mind now, tell God that you need God's help. Psalm 46:11. The Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. Huh? That sounds just like verse 46, chapter 46, verse 7, where it said, the Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. David continues to remind us, this one who had to run from his life more than once in his lifetime. Who is his place of safety? Who is his refuge? It's the God of Jacob. Who is the place of safety? There will be fears. But who is our place of safety? And so, friends, you've named them. You've asked God to help you with those worries and fears. Here's the next part we're going to ask you to do. Please bear with me. For some of you, you're going to find this very weird. For some of you, this will be helpful. Open up your hands. Hold them up like this. Because we're getting close to the end. Praise the Lord. Good job. Do you want to do that? The worries and fears you may have. Okay? Name them to yourself. If you want to mutter them, go ahead. For some of us, it's going to be only a couple of worries. And for some of us, it's going to seem like the list goes on forever. But name what you can. So, my friends, let them go. Father, they're yours. I encourage your friends again to breathe in deeply. To be still and know that God is God. To exhale. Because the Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. The Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. The Lord of heavenly forces is with us. The God of Jacob is our place of safety. Friends, give them over to God so that you can be still. The worries, the fears, and in my mind, the to-do list as well. Give it over to God. Be still and know that God is God. Well, my friends, here's your assignment this week, if you choose to accept it. Take time to be still and know that God is God. So take 5 minutes each day to intentionally know that God is God. That might be reading Psalm 46, verse 10, or all of Psalm 46, over and over until something stands out to you. It might be reading aloud Psalm 46. It might be while you're driving, pray out loud, of course, with your eyes open. That's putting faith a little too much into God's hands, maybe more so being stupid about faith. And then sit on your porch, maybe, or somewhere that feels safe to you, and in silence for 5 minutes. When I've been able to make myself sit silent on the porch, we've had hummingbirds show up at our back porch. We're in downtown Mercer. Well, you know what I mean. You know, it's not like we're out in the country. We've had these cardinals have been flipping by the back porch. If I'm running around all the time, keeping busy, I miss all of it. I've never seen a hummingbird get 30 or 40 feet in the air like I have in the last couple days. Totally shocking. Why do I bring that up? Being still and knowing that God is God, you may be completely surprised by what God shows you or what God tells you. Because my friends, this is tough. The coronavirus is tough. If those numbers are indicative, 60% of people are very concerned about family members. 46% are very concerned they might contract the coronavirus themselves. Those numbers didn't even exist more than 6 months ago for most of us. This is brand new. How do we make it go? On Psalm 46, Psalm 46, verse 10, David reminds us, be still and know that I'm God. Amen. Would you pray with me? You can find the prayer on the screen behind me. But I'm encouraging you to instead close your eyes and turn your hands up toward heaven. Repeating after me, let us pray. Lord God, loving Father.
Lord God, loving Father.
I love you.
I love you.
You are my refuge and my strength.
You are my refuge and my strength.
You are always near in times of trouble.
You are always near in times of trouble.
I won't be afraid when the world falls apart.
I won't be afraid when the world falls apart.
You are awesome, God.
You are awesome.
You are the Lord of heavenly forces.
You are the Lord of heavenly forces.
You are my place of safety.
You are my place of safety.
You will bring about peace on earth.
You will bring about peace on earth.
I know that you are God.
I know that you are God.
That you're God over all.
You are God over all.
You are the Lord of heavenly forces.
You are the Lord of heavenly forces.
You are my place of safety.
You are my place of safety.
I praise your name.
I praise your name.
I love you.
I love you.
I pray in Jesus' name.
I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Friends, to sing together, open my eyes.